My guest today is Greg Stockel, who is a recent addition to our staff at Learning English. And Greg has written a story about a bookstore in Washington, D.C. Would you like to share that story with us?
Yes, let me share my screen so we can take a look. Okay, so this piece was about independent bookstores, which means that it is a bookstore that is not a chain. So it's owned locally. It may have a few locations, but not many. This one is Capitol Hill Books, which is a bookstore in DC. And it was talking about how bookstores, independent bookstores specifically, have done moderately well during the pandemic in the United States. And this bookstore, for example, started a program called Grab Bag, which was a bag of books mostly used, and it would depend on the type of books the buyer wanted. So if you wanted mystery books or crime series or science fiction, they would put together some books that fit that category. And then they would show you which books they picked out. And if you liked them, then they would prepare it. They talked about how it was very popular. So it talked about an association of bookstores in the United States and how they were looking at their members and how to get more diversity amongst the bookstores, so minority-owned bookstores in the association.
So usually what happens is after we have shared a story with you, we ask some questions on a topic for you to practice speaking.
Yeah.
So go ahead, Greg.
So I would like to know, what are bookstores like in your countries? If you could describe maybe the atmosphere or the size, the location, stuff like that.
Then Helen?
Well, in Colombia, we can find different bookstores, and the size is very big, and you can find different books depending on your light or what you like to read. But the problem was in the lockdown, many bookstores closed because the pandemic began. But right now, the bookstore open again.
That's good to hear. It's similar here. They're starting to reopen again. They were taking appointments in the States, so they would only let in certain people and at certain times, and some of the books were outside.
Yes. Before I share the stores in my country, first of all, I would say I finally matched the voice on VOA to Greg's, because I listened to a lot of articles from Greg's read. So beautiful. Thank you. Really. Okay. Even yesterday, I listened to this. And the article you mentioned, I listened to. So in China, we have a lot of bookstores. Before 1980, I think all bookstores owned by state government, like state-owned bookstores. But after that, our country opened to the world and started to reform. So, well, all bookstores owned by government and private section, and the books, the owners are more rich than before. Not just the politics, you know, and a lot of economics, arts and the novel and everything. So and I think nowadays a lot of stores even designed like a modern building, and you can enjoy coffee or tea and reading there, like sit down in a library. And I think during pandemic, especially the beginning, really locked down. And I think now fully opened everybody can go to store to look for what you like and enjoy reading there. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. It's really interesting to see the new bookstores that are being built in China. I'll see like pictures of the design and they're stunning. Although I don't understand how people get to the books because they'll like have it in layers and I don't understand how they, you know, pull the books out.
I think there is an assistant to help them. Yeah, thank you.
Oh, okay. Yeah, somebody to move the bookshelves that are overlapping, is it?
Yeah, they're like, I don't even know how to describe it. There was this one that I saw, I think that was recently built, and it was like a wave almost, like the wall was a wave. And so the books, like the shelves, would come out by each layer. So the wall wasn't flat, it was curved. Hmm. Very stunning.
And Helen mentioned a very common trend to have a coffee shop or tea shop in the bookstore, I think to encourage you to take more time to look at the books, right? And to relax.
Yeah. Attract more customers.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, come in for a cup of coffee and maybe buy a book too. Yeah.
I was actually going to ask about that, but we can, you know, continue on this question. Maria, what would you like to say?
Yes, here in Uruguay, here we have many bookstores and we can read, they have all kinds of books and you can read what you want, you can find the book you want. But now, by the pandemic was, now, recent now, began to open again, but by the pandemic, they was closed all last year and part of this year, who was close, read. Then now, a few times this week, a few time ago, was open, and well, you can go and buy books. And we have then some bookstores that have a place you can read in the bookstores. Choose a book and read the bookstores, and then if you want, you can buy it or not. But we have a few bookstores like that, yes. But we can read what we want.
We haven't heard from Victoria. Victoria, would you like to tell us about the bookstores in Tajikistan?
Yeah, I would like to give an example. So during pandemic, when everything closed all of a sudden, one of my colleagues was teaching corporate group where students were, maybe I would say that they were not young by age. They were maybe middle-aged or mature students, and some of them didn't know how to use computers and they had problem with eyesight. So that teacher had to print out all textbooks at home because the book shop was closed, and she paid to the taxi driver to deliver the books to students. And I'm amazed by her perseverance and love for students. So this is an example how pandemic can hit. She said that my students didn't know how to use Zoom, how to use Teams, and they just complained that their eyes hurt. That's why she printed out books for them, so at least she could meet online, but they could use the book. Mm-hmm. And in Tajikistan, I can tell you which bookstore is the most popular. It's the bookstore with English books and with textbooks for children. So, of course, the supply of books is very limited. For example, we have like English file, like certain books, because they bring only those books which they are sure they can sell. But if you need like some modern books, maybe you want to have solutions for pupils or like new editions, then you will have problems. You will have to ask acquaintances or relatives who go to Moscow or to another country so that they could bring this book for you.
Uh-huh. Yeah. I think we're pretty spoiled here where we can order books online easily, but I know in other countries it's sometimes really difficult to get the books that you want. this bookseller doesn't. That's an interesting story about the teacher printing the textbooks for the students. Yeah.
I have a question. So I found it surprising that the English literature was the most popular at the English bookstore. Is Russian bookstores, are they popular in Tajikistan?
I can answer your question. English is considered the language of opportunity. People have big hopes that if you have English, you can study abroad, you can find a better job. That's why, of course, English textbooks are more popular now.
Okay, that's very interesting.
In the Shambra area, and there's someone is what's the full name? Brother Noble.
Barnes and Noble.
Yeah, Barnes Noble. Yeah, but unfortunately, I have never been that bookstore close to my area. But when I visit my friends in the other city, and I visit the Barnes Noble, that seen my. The English other than my word is so bad. So that boosts up frequently. You know, I stay there in the reading books and waiting my friends to drink coffee. But I would say that bookstore is quite similar to the one introduced by Greg.
Yeah. So we're talking about bookstores. And I was going to say there's a few different types of bookstores in the States. So we have very large chain bookstores like Barnes & Noble, which Kelly mentioned, which is a very large store. They have all different types of books, sometimes like CDs or other media that you can find. And they'll have a cafe and you can get sandwiches and coffee and pastries. And then we have independent bookstores, which is what the piece was about, which are smaller bookstores that generally maybe specialize in something, maybe a specific type of literature, or this bookstore that I showed was used books. And they're usually smaller and they don't have cafes typically. But DC has a type of bookstore that we didn't have in Ohio, which is bookstores that like include a restaurant where you can get drinks and lunch, and it's kind of split 50-50, and they're open late apparently, like until 4 a.m. or something. So,
oh, are you thinking of Busboys and Poets?
Yeah, I was thinking of that and a couple others.
Yeah, so these are bookstores that are also usually run by activists, people who want to have community events in this bookstore, and often have the writers come and read their books aloud, read sections of the book, and answer questions from their readers. They're usually very active in their community. Busboys and Poets is a really well known one in DC. I've been to some book events there where the author, you know, introduced a new book, that kind of thing. And they sometimes have music too. The performers come in and play music.
Yeah, they're very interesting. And I didn't know they existed until I moved here.
Oh, yeah.
So we mentioned this and I am curious. So what are some typical foods or drinks that people think of or have when they're in a bookstore or reading, or is it like tea? But is there things you have with the tea, stuff like that?
So in the bookstore that has like that serves a drink, what do they serve? What do you like to drink? Okay. Ichan has a hand up.
In my country, people usually drink coffee or tea while reading books or magazines. But I can't concentrate reading a book while eating something or drinking, so I don't like so much.
Fair. I relate to that. David, what would you like to say?
Yes, in Colombia it's very common the Colombian coffee, but in the bookstore and the libraries, it's not allowed to eat or take drinks inside the place, but you always can find a place or coffee very close to the bookstore or the library, so you can take the book and read the book inside this place.
Okay.
And enjoy your coffee.
So I noticed a couple people joined us in the last few minutes. Hagar?
Yes.
And Miguel, would you like to introduce yourself?
Yes, this is Hagar from Egypt. I'm a translator. I just want to join this event. This sounds interesting to me.
Welcome. We're talking about bookstores today. Are the bookstores opened yet in Egypt?
Actually, bookstores are not, public bookstores are not something that's common in Egypt here. Maybe we have a shortage of this facilities. We just have bookstores, like private bookstores, only to buy books, not to read or enjoy reading in the library. The thing is that we have different bookshops just to buy books and read it at home.
And Miguel, where are you?
I am Miguel, and I am from Mexico. Here we have no open bookstores, but we can buy shops. We can buy books at the department shops, and that's the only way to buy books here.
Mm-hmm. All right. So, Greg, do you have another question?
Yes. We talked about this a little bit, but I'm curious. Are there more independent bookstores, so small, locally owned bookstores or chains in your country? Are there larger bookstores that are more popular?
Yes, in Egypt, for example, we have Alexandria Library. It's a huge library. It's a historic place. This is the most where is the most enjoyable place I have ever visited in terms of books. We also have the book fair, which is held each year. It's a book reading event. These two remarkable places where in Egypt it's a very
The Alexandria Library, yes, that's very famous.
Yes.
In Washington, D.C., here we have the Library of Congress, which is a arm of the government that stores all the books that are published in the United States, or a record of them. It's an amazing place to go if you're doing research.
Oh, of course, I have some favorite book stores. Now my favorite, which I was young, I sometimes went there, and now I like to go there to remember when I was young, I was coming there, only in this way.
Uh-huh.
So I don't often go to bookshops and buy books, not very often.
Now, did you have your trip to England?
No. Flight was changed twice.
Oh, no.
It was changed.
Oh, no.
Yes.
I thought maybe you're in England now.
No.
He was telling us last time we talked about going to England.
No, unfortunately, all flights changed again.
Oh, too bad. All right. So we talked about bookstores. How about the books that are in them? Greg, do you have a question about that?
Yes. So what type of books do you enjoy reading? And do you have any recommendations?
Many of us had a lot of time over the last year to do some reading, right? In lockdown.
No. Before now, I have been studying English very hardly. I spent all my time with English. Before, I like to read Russian classics. Classic books, not Tolstoy. No, I don't like Tolstoy. We have many other. Karolenko, for example. I love Karolenko, writer. For example, he wrote Blind Musician. Oh, it's impossible. I can't read it second time because it's very touchy. Roman, I can't read it second time. But it's very good. It depicts how a boy was born blind. And one sentence, he asked his mother, "Mother, why I am like this?" And very sad to read this novel. Very sad.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah. All right, Hagar, how about you?
I started reading since the pandemic, and I started with a very sad book, which is 100 Years of Isolation. It was very sad to me. I couldn't even complete the book, full of details, and I almost hate reading after reading this book. Then I gave it a second chance with another book, and it was really the type of books that I love was The Power of Your Subconscious Mind. I love reading this book. It gives me something moral feeling. It helps me a lot to open my mind, to open my heart, to give a chance to myself, to my children, to the life. I really loved reading and loved my life after reading this book.
All right. Oh, so the book, first book you mentioned was 100 Years of Solitude, right, by Gabriel Garcia Marquez. I think our Colombian and Mexican guest.
Yes. Every time I'm feeling sad, I draw the from my from the bookshelves and read about two pages, and then close the book and put it again to the shelf.
All right. Yeah, when you're in isolation yourself, it's no good to read about isolation.
I read it only when I'm feeling sad.
All right. Thank you, Hagar. Helen, what book would you like to recommend?
During the pandemic, most of my time was spent on learning. One main part of it is on reading and listening. The program American on VOA, American Stories. So next I will share one of my favorite stories. On VOA is the Murders in the Rue Morgue by Edgar Allan Poe. I read a lot. So I really like his works. The story is full of mystery. The story is about a mother and her daughter were killed by brutal murders, and how to find the killers by an unprofessional detective Dupin. The author designed a really fascinating plot. As a reader, you never thought of something would happen in a way you thought or you guessed. So I always guess what would happen in the next part, because this story divided in five parts. That means 5 weeks. So every time when I finished the last part, I can't wait the next part. And I guess what will happen? What will happen? So really. So I have three gains from the story. So first of all, reading books widely will help you get a power of reasoning and the ability of reading others' minds, like Dupin. Really, I admire him. And you can say what a stunning conclusion. I've never thought an animal with a much stronger power than human killed the mother and the daughter. But Dupin uh-huh. was not a professional detective, you know, and he focused on the details which police ignored. He observed and reasoned who could climb the pole. The mark left on the daughter's neck and the hair was grabbing in the
okay,
mother's head.
You're giving a, you should give a spoiler alert, Helen, because you're giving away the end of the story.
Yeah, and the last thing I learned is how tells a story. Like teachers in VOA, through their voice, intonation, and the emotion. So I learned a lot, not just the story, and about how to learn English. Thank you, Dr. Jill and the VOA.
Well, the interesting thing about that story in particular, that's by Edgar Allan Poe, and it was the very first detective story in fiction. And at least, you know, in the English language, and maybe others in other languages, but in English literature, it's seen as the very first detective story. And the detective was Auguste Dupin, who was a French policeman. And it's a great story. So I put the link in there if you want to read those or listen to them. We have little videos and you can listen and watch the words go by as you listen to them. How about Victoria? What would you like to recommend?
I would like to recommend two books. One is The Year of Wonders by Geraldine Brooks. She talks about the plague of 1666. And I'm sure with the current circumstances, people would love it. Because it can go in parallel, for example, how she describes the symptoms of the plague. But the story is not only about plague, it's about how a person can be mistaken. Because at the end, she comes to the harem and she thinks that it's much better than the life that she had in the village. And it's such a mistake. So the second book that I recommend is The Mountains Sing by Nguyen. It's about the strong love of mother, how many hardships she passes, how many problems she has, but she still loves her children. And the story also teaches you that when you do evil, evil goes back to you. So if you like books that can't keep you like quiet, you become emotional, you want to hit somebody, you want to strangle somebody, these books are like for you, because I couldn't like stay calm when I was reading these books.
Tell us the name of the second one again.
The second one is, if you want, you can type, it's The Mountains Sing.
Mountains Sing?
Okay. It's about the war in Vietnam, and it starts about she is a little girl, and how she's a mother, how she's a grandmother.
This is interesting session today, right, Greg?
Yeah.
People drifting in throughout the hour. We just had Diego join us. Maria, what would you like to recommend?
Yes. Well, I like read so much, read, and very much. And I like biography. I like too much biography. I recommend a book called When Life Calls Out to Us. The author is Haddon Greenberg Jr., and the book is about Victor Frankl's life, the biography that writer write about Victor Frankl, and it's a very very good book, because began in the first in the time of when the he is a doctor, a psychiatric doctor, and then began the war, World War II, and how he chose to stay, don't go out, many person, and as Freud, he too, he went to US in those time, but Viktor Frankl stayed there in Germany, and he was made prisoner, and he passed in concentration camps when as the World War II ends, and his biography talks about his life before, during, and after the war, and how he made a logotherapy school, and it's very, very, very nice. I recommend it to you.
All right, yeah, Viktor Frankl.
Yes. The name is When Life Calls Out to Us.
Yeah, I put it in the chat, a link to the Goodreads page about it.
Yes. And another biography I like is Mandela. Mandela biography.
Mm. Okay, I recommend A Man Searching a Meaning. By Viktor Frankl. It's a great novel. The author explained about the slavery in the World War against Nazis. It's good reading. He talks about experience inside a jail in camp concentration. Is very painful for inmates. I like reading too much to jog your memory. To entertain reading books is a way to find a true friend, and book is like a friend.
Yeah. If you have another one, yeah, sure.
Yeah, so I was curious how it is for you to read in English. Do you find that there's any difficulties? Maybe some advantages. Do you prefer reading in English in your native language, doing both? So just your thoughts on that.
And I just remembered what I was going to say about what Diego said. Sorry. Diego mentioned how much he can learn from books. I always recommend to my students, if they want to improve their vocabulary, to read in English, because just seeing the words in context really it makes them stay better in your memory than trying to learn them individually. I see Valerie's got his hand up. Hi.
Yes. But my idea about this, but I prefer reading Russian books in Russian, but American English authors I would like to read in English, because translation isn't a correct idea, not always correct translation, because sometimes I don't want to read in what interpreter said. I want to read what the author said.
So you like to read in the original language?
Yes. Uh-huh.
How about you, Hagar?
I actually agree with Valerie. This is the same here. I Although I'm a translator myself, I'd like to read the original language of the book or of the author. Aside from that, it really helps me to gain more vocabularies, as you said, Jill, and to have the original feeling of the author of the story or the book. And it also feels authentic to read from the original person, to have his idea delivered as just he wants to deliver it.
Okay. From the horse's mouth, as they say. All right. Yeah, thank you. David?
I agree with Valerie and Agar about the language for wood, because if the book was right in English, I prefer read in English, because when you read in other language, maybe sometimes the feelings or the words or the ideas are missing in the translation. But when you read in English, you can learn more words, more expressions, and you can understand very well the main idea for the author.
Yes, I really like to read in English. Every day I read 1 hour or a few or half an hour, and I understand very well when I read. Better, many times better than when we are talking, but reading is more easy for me, and I think it's very useful to learn and to speak in English. And the book I love in English, or usually read, are pocket books, because I take with me, and where I was, I read. And in this moment, I'm reading, this is a big book, it's in pocket, but it's a book of like a biography, as I like, is from Tigret, is the name, and he's American, and he made the first toys factories in UA, and he created the Hard Rock Cafe, and then Hard Rock Cafe is, yes, is a Tigretes. His name.
Huh. I'm not sure if I'm familiar with that person. Tigret. Isaac, yes. Tigret?
Tigret, yes.
Huh. Okay. All right. Well, thank you, Maria. And Greg, would you like to wrap things up for us here?
Sure. Thank you, everyone, for joining. It was a very interesting discussion. I learned a lot about bookstores in other countries and also some books to read.
And everybody, would you join me in thanking Greg for sharing his story with us today?